Well, good morning and welcome to Rock Harbor. We're so glad that you're tuning in with us online today. And obviously, this is not what we had anticipated. It's not what we had planned, but we know that God has something greater for us today than maybe we could even think or imagine. And you know, sometimes we look at technology and we go, man, technology's taking us down the wrong path. But today we look at this and we say we can actually leverage it, right, for the greater good. And so we want to thank you for tuning in with us today. And the band's here, and we're going to start singing here in just a few moments. But we want to welcome you, especially if this is your very first time, and just say thanks for coming and meeting with us today. Let's go ahead and sing together.
The dark tried to hide you and steal you away. Death tried to keep you inside of the grave. The enemy fought you, he tried but he lost. You cannot be stopped. We cried out for freedom. When we cried for freedom, you tore down the walls. The weight of our burdens, you carry it all.
Our fears and our failures, come on.
Our fears and our failures, hang dead on the cross. You cannot be stopped.
Today to celebrate that you are sovereign, that you are Lord of all. We're here to bless your name, God, to sing that you are the King over darkness, We celebrate that today.
Awesome today, and obviously we want to start things out with worship. We want to welcome you. My name is Scott. This is Brandon, and obviously this is a little bit different. Normally we would say, hey, if this is your first time here, we want to welcome you and thank you so much, and we'd love to get to meet you. We want to encourage you following the service to go out to the tent, but we can't see you, and there's no tent
today. So maybe go refresh your coffee,
you know,
do whatever you need to do, get back to the couch and join us.
Or maybe go to your refrigerator. Yeah. Sometimes I find gifts there. Normally we give you a gift. There could be a gift there maybe.
Scott, you know? Speaking of gifts.
Here you go.
I think this is a gift right now.
This is what's going on around here.
This
is a pretty big gift. Yeah, if you can find these, these are limited edition.
What if, just to just pay off this building thing we're doing, what if we auction these off?
That's a great idea.
Just an online digital auction real quick.
Give me one, give me two, give me three, four. Yep. Here we go. Yeah, there you go. Have a roll of toilet paper for you. Thank you so much. Obviously, want to welcome you here and are grateful that you've chosen to be with us today.
Yes, definitely. And we've got an incredible service planned for you guys. And I know, obviously, you know that our weekly gatherings have changed, our public gatherings. We want to just give you a little bit of a heads up on what's going forward here. We're going to be suspending also any of our gatherings during the week that are 50 plus people. And so that includes our Anchor High School, our Porch Young Adults Ministry, and then also our Wednesday night re-engage. And that leaves the question of what about community groups?
Well, yes.
And so we want to just give you a heads up. Community groups, they're smaller groups. We're totally comfortable if you guys want to meet, if that's something that you're comfortable with. So just reach out to your community group leader and you guys will be able to make that decision on your own. We also want to let you know of just what we're going to be doing going forward. Obviously, things are changing like quick,
minute by minute.
Super quick.
Yes.
Yes, they're changing fast. And so every Thursday by noon, we're going to put out an update via our weekly newsletter email. We're going to be on our social media. We're going to do as best we can to get the information out to you on what the plan will be for that next Sunday's meeting. And then also our kids team's going to be working hard this week. And even today, they're going to be emailing out all of you families some information for you to sit down with your kids sometime today. We don't want to have the kids be left out during this time. This is for kind of the adult and the whole family, but we want to be able to resource families as well. So our kids team is going to email you guys something today that you can walk through with them as well.
Absolutely. When we think about these times, this is an opportunity for us, right, to be the hands and the feet of Jesus. We talk about serving oftentimes, what that looks like for us, and how can we do that practically today. Maybe you have a neighbor, maybe a coworker, somebody that maybe is up in age a little bit. This is an opportunity for us to really neighbor, right?
Definitely.
It's like, how can we do that better? Maybe it's calling a neighbor and saying, what can I do to maybe help you? Maybe you need something. My wife, she called a couple of our neighbors who are in their 80s and said, hey, is there something I can grab for you? And they're like, we need chicken. I'm like, okay, we can go to the store and get you some chicken. But you know, how do we neighbor? This is a great opportunity, right, for us to do that. We think about even yesterday we were able to do that. We had our Feed My Starving Children event, and you know, we had two different sessions. Both of them were under the 250 threshold that the city governments have said, please don't have any gatherings larger than that. We had a total of 403 volunteers actually at both different locations, at both different times, and we were able to pack over 217,288 meals, which is just incredible, right?
Unbelievable.
And it's amazing when you get your mind off of everything else that's going on in the world, and you begin to serve somebody else, how that really changes our perspective.
Yeah, well, you look at the early church in Acts, right?
That's what
Chapter
they did.
Two, and they did things. They went against social norms, selling things that they had in order to take care of each other. And I think there's a unique opportunity for us to do that even now. I mean, even if it's taking a roll of toilet paper over to your neighbor and saying, hey, I've got one for you. But just thinking of ways outside the box. Let's be a church, Rock Harbor, that thinks outside the box and serves people in unique ways during really unique times.
Yeah, really. That's well said, Brandon. And you know, we think about, you know, the president actually said that today is a national day of prayer. And for many of us, we have some different concerns. We have some anxiety that comes around this. And 1 Peter 5:7 says to cast all your anxiety upon him because he cares for you. So we thought it would be appropriate today maybe just to start our service out in the middle and just take a moment to pray. Even where you are today, just say, here's some things I need to be praying about. And maybe it's, I'm thinking about myself personally. There's some things going on there. Maybe it's at work, or maybe it's with my children, or maybe it's in a marriage. I don't know where it might be, but just spend some time praying and asking God, how can I be like your hands and how can I be your feet? Let's pray together today. Father, we're so grateful for you and for what you've done for us. And even in the midst of uncertainty, even in the midst of a difficult time and maybe unprecedented pandemic that's going on in our nation that's gripped it, Father, our prayer is we would just focus our eyes and our attention on you. And God, we would cast our anxiety upon you because we know that you're in control of all things. God, you've got this. You know what's going to happen in the end. God, we just trust you with it. And we ask you to be with us today. We ask these things in your son's name. Amen.
Amen. Well, hey, it's really not a different Sunday in terms of what we're doing. We're going to be just continuing our series, Joyful. We've been working our way through the book of Philippians. We've got 3 weeks left, and we're going to be hearing from Keith Haring today.
Hey, we want to welcome all of you. This is very exciting to be able to be speaking today and be able to connect with so many people all over the world. Lots of questions are being asked right now, and we have this ever-changing world around us. But here's the reality, okay? We have a never-changing God, okay? Even though things might be changing or it's always a little bit different, there is this ever-faithful God, and he has the answers to our questions today. Something that's pretty cool is I was thinking about this series and coming out and all the news and everything. It's like, hey, it's joyful. I would say, what about fearful? You know, that's what you see is a lot of fear, just experiencing different things on whether it's social media or just in the community. Maybe you went to Winco, maybe went to Albertsons, maybe went to Fred Meyer, maybe went to Walmart. I probably should list all of them to be equal opportunity here. But there is a craze that's going on. And here's the thing that we have in a relationship with God is we have this, okay? The joy of the Lord is our strength. How can you be joyful at a time that there's so much fear that's involved? Well, we can come. We have an answer. There's an answer not just given to us in Scripture, but absolutely. There's an answer that can be alive in us as the church. And a verse, a piece of verses that I have been looking at this week is in Philippians 1. Philippians 1, verse 3 through 6, it says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. See, this is twofold because it's about the community that we live in, the things that we're facing in our nation and our world right now, but also the journey that we've been on as a family to thank God upon our every remembrance of you. Then it talks about prayer in the next verse. It says, always in every prayer of mine for you, making my prayer with joy, to pray with joy. That's where the strength comes from, to be full of that joy. And then because of your partnership in the gospel from the very first, okay, from the first day until now, the faithfulness of God. And I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work in you is going to be faithful until the day of Christ Jesus to complete it, to finish it, okay? There is joy that we can have. See, when I think about the last 3 months of our family's life, it's been 3 months to the day that I haven't preached, been involved in the office, I've been around, been doing different things, went to Ethiopia for a season. But today, to be preaching, and also this verse to go, okay, I have nothing but gratitude and thankfulness, our family, for this church, for the love that you guys have shown to us, for our elders, our staff, the leadership. We absolutely love what God has been doing through his church to encourage us, his faithfulness, the joy, the continued prayer. For God is a faithful God. And even to have a privilege of teaching the word of God, I'm just thinking like Paul was a pastor, you know, that is in this, he wrote this letter to the church in Philippi, and to think the preaching that he did and what is the purpose of preaching and where does that come from and the call of that and the privilege of that, the opportunity to do that. See, preaching comes from this Greek word, kairoso. I want to say caruso because of Daniel LaRusso and the Karate Kid, but it's not. It's not caruso, it's kairoso, and it means to herald, to proclaim, to stir up one another, you know, to good works. Hebrews 10 talks specifically about that. That's our job as a church, is to stir one another up, and that's what preaching and teaching is. It's our opportunity, as God has called, as he has set apart for us, to stir up and encourage one another, to use our words by sharing his word. It's studying at an in-depth level and then sharing it. You know what else it is? It's illustrating God's word. You see often Paul and multiple people throughout Scripture, they illustrate what's going on in that day and that time to better explain culturally what's taking place. The practical application of preaching. You know, what's the point to just lecture and then go, deuces, see you guys, have a great week, you know. No, the point is to, how do we practically apply this to our life? What is the instruction given to us from God's word on how we should live, how we should operate, and what's the ultimate goal of preaching? It's just like you parents in your lectures and your kind instructions that you have to repeat over and over with your kids, right? It's a life change. It's life change. I'm going to have this moment with you in the car because I'm dissatisfied with what you may be doing, or I'm just trying to call you up into something. It's to see life change, and that's what preaching is, whether through passion, whether the type of preaching is a teaching moment. It's a chance for Paul and for us as we herald the gospel to be able to share, why communicate the gospel? What's the importance of the gospel? And right now in this day, And this time, I mean, to have services online, not just at here at Rock Harbor, but all throughout the nation, technology to think how God is being glorified. And there has been social media flooded with all types of messages. And guess what's happening today, church? It's happening. Right? It's happening. The gospel is going out through feed after feed, and people are sharing things. They're saying, check this out. And the message of Christ is being proclaimed that even in the hard times, and what we're going to talk about today is, how do you press on when you're pressed on? How do you press on when you're pressed on? Well, guess what? God's given us resource in front of us that we can press into him. See, Paul pushes on this church, and he's saying, hey, let me illustrate to you a couple of different things. See, in Paul's preaching, he used a couple of things to illustrate, one of which, he used the military. That's why he says, you know, put on the whole armor of God. So he used that because people understood things of the military. He used architecture, for we are the temple of God. Using structures to say, your body, your life, it's the temple. He dwells inside of us. It's a picture for us. He also uses agriculture, and yeehaw, that's my favorite, okay? He uses agriculture, and he talks about, hey, you know, whatsoever a man sows, he will also reap. I don't always love that verse and that illustration, but agriculture. See, in that day and time, it meant a lot. You know why? Because a significant portion of the population in those days and times, they were farmers, they were ranchers, they were into agriculture. I grew up on a farm. I grew up farming. I grew up ranching. I grew up around it. And guess what? At this day and time, only 1.3% of the United States of America is involved with agriculture. That's a flat-out shame, okay? That's a shame. Okay, maybe it's just my childhood, and I want more people to be able to relate to what I navigated in those days and times. 100 years ago in our nation, 50% of our nation was involved in ranching and agriculture. How times have changed. So when Paul is talking about agriculture, everybody got it. Everybody was understanding the sowing and the reaping. Today, we're going to look at one of the four things, an illustration that he used to tie it in. It's that of athletics. And I know some of you guys, some of you ladies, you're like, okay, now we're talking. You know, I'm at the house, I'm watching ESPN, but I'm also watching this message on my phone right now as well. So I'm just multitasking. I'm trying to glorify God in both ways, and it totally connects. Athletics. Paul uses this. And see, in our Bibles, we're going to be in Philippians 3. We're going to start in verse number 12 and continue throughout the chapter. But see, in our Bibles, this is a set of verses and chapters. But in this day and time, when Paul wrote this letter, it had been more of a paragraph form. And so in this paragraph that we're going to read today, just note that Paul is illustrating athletics. He's using athletics to illustrate what God wants us to understand. Verse 12, it says, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfected, but I press on to make it known because Christ Jesus had made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I've made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straying forward to what lies ahead. And this next verse is huge. This next verse really It talks about the times that we have directly in front of us right now. I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ Jesus. Let those of us who think, those of us mature, think this way. And if anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that also to you. Only let us hold true to what we have obtained. Let's pray together. God, we thank you so much for your word that we get to be in today. We thank you for the opportunity that no matter what may be going on, you are on the throne. Even though times may be ever changing, we know that you are ever faithful. You're with us in this season and in this time for not your church to get the glory, but for you to get the glory. You've given us the church in order that we may fellowship and commune together. So whether that's through a video stream, whether that's in a living room or in a car or in a break room, God, that we can have an opportunity today to hear from your word. God, let us be moved. We're being pressed on, and we need to know, we need encouragement, we need collaboration in order to press on as the body of Christ should, for your glory and your glory alone. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Well, hey, I know this. As I was studying, theologians kind of go back and forth a little bit on whether Paul was referencing this pressing on, this straining forward, this race that's happening. Is it a chariot race or is it a foot race? I've always thought foot race, but I'm going to be honest with you. I think the chariot race is just a lot cooler. I mean, think about that, chariot, like real horsepower, you know, real horsepower in front of you, you know, you're on this little small, like, platform. I mean, the Greek chariots that were used in this day and time, they weren't maybe these big walled, kind of just real stable chariots. No, we're talking like a little platform, like something that you would build in your garage for a science project, or your dad would build and you got an A, right? You know, or something like that. You know, they're standing on it, they have to balance, it's a small platform, they've got to move their body. So when it says to strain forward, to lean forward, there's this physical action that takes place. I mean, you've got to limber up, you know? It's kind of like, I think like me doing a TikTok, you know, I have to limber up before I do a TikTok or something. I'm at my age, somebody's going to get hurt. So as I get into it and I start going, you know, and I renegade, you know, I do all these things. Like, you got to loosen up. Think about the chariot. They're limbering up. So when it's saying to press forward, to strain forward, the competition that's taking place, leaning towards that finish line, to finish a race that is set before us, not for us to strain forward to earn something, to earn our salvation, but rather, no. It says we're a citizen, like we're already in. Brandon and John and John and Travis and Scott and this whole team's been talking about the fact we're not straining to gain salvation in Jesus. We have it, but because we are in this competition, we're straining forward to glorify God. To strain forward, if you're pressing on, can you really say that you're straining? Are you kind of just, I'm a follower of Jesus, just a little bit of a lean? Or is it very active where you're like, I'm willing to do anything? Because some of us sadly aren't even breaking a sweat. And Paul is saying, our very lives need to be on the line pressing forward. So how do we press on when we're pressed on? You know, this pressing on, this idea of wanting to back down and it's difficult and I'm going to scale back, or am I going to press on? This desire that we have sometimes to quit because we have doubt, or just to shut in our homes because we're scared of what might go on, or just abandon a certain situation because having a conversation or dealing with the conflict may be too difficult. When we think about a relationship with God, maybe there's just too many questions. We're just stepping back and saying, I am so tired. I'm exhausted. I can't press on. My first point might sound a little bit confusing. It might cause us to go, okay, what does that mean? That doesn't sound encouraging. It's this, like, how to press on when we're pressed on. The first thing is to be dissatisfied. And so you're like, that's no problem for me. You know, if dissatisfaction was like a major in college, I would have been a valedictorian. You know, like, I've been dissatisfied for a long time. Check. Well, let me explain this a little bit, because Paul is actually dissatisfied with the spiritual progress that he's made. He's struggling with some of the progress that he would desire in his life by this point. And he's saying, I'm not there yet. It's like an athlete saying, I still have goals that I want to attain. That's why in verse 12 it says, not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. See, Paul didn't allow himself, even with his spiritual attainment and the things that he had done or qualified for because of his heritage, because of his upbringing, he said, no, I'm humble about this. I'm desiring improvement. You know what he had? A divine dissatisfaction. And a divine dissatisfaction, it's important. It's necessary. It's essential for spiritual progress. You have to be recognize, like, hey, where I'm at is not where I want to be. There's still progress to be made. Not to be more saved, not to be, you know, officially a follower of Jesus, but to say, you know what? I'm pressing on. I'm striving forward. See, many of the followers of Jesus in that day and time and now, we become self-satisfied with the progress that we've made because we simply look over here or look over there and we compare our progress with others. And so we become satisfied because of the standard that might be around us. And here's the thing, Paul's saying, no, the standard is Jesus Christ. We are not there yet. We're not even close to there yet. And Paul says, hey, I haven't arrived. I'm not at perfection. Verse 15, he says, he refers to himself, and we will get there, as mature. Mature. He refers to himself as mature, and maturity, a sign of maturity, is saying, I don't know it all. I know there's probably some teenagers in the room right now, and you kind of thinking, I kind of have it figured out, and my parents don't. There may come a day, there will, I don't want to spoil like the ending, but there will come a day where you recognize they actually knew a lot, okay? Maturity says, I don't have it figured out. I'm not perfect, but I'm pressing on. And over in Scripture, we're warned against poorly evaluating ourselves spiritually, to not think too highly. And what we do, we err one of two directions, right? We either think too highly of ourselves, and Scripture says, hey, take heed lest you fall. Or what do? We think not enough of ourselves. And yet in Christ, we are overcomers, Jesus says. Like in him, we are overcomers. My question is, what are you thirsty for? Well, where did that come from, Keith? Well, it came from a song I used to sing when I was a kid. I'm not going to sing it now because I sang it when I was a kid. I already TikToked, and that's, I think, all I can handle today, okay? But here's the thing. It's in Psalm 42. It talks about the deer that pants for the water, so my soul longs after you. What are you thirsty for? Because if we're straining for and we're longing for and we're going to take that long game trail of life to get to the water because we long for what can truly fill us, the eternal life, the springs of eternity that can fill us. It comes from God and from him alone. So what are we thirsty for? What are we straining for? What are we dissatisfied with that we want to change? And what will actually quench the thirst that's inside of us? See, what we often do is we look to the rivers of this world rather to the eternal, true, fulfilling, thirst-quenching water that our soul should pant for. Like, pant? I don't pant. Well, when you're longing for something, you will. When you long for something, it's like that guy that likes that girl that's like, and you're like, poof, you know? I mean, it's like, you know, he's like, I like her. I long for her. My soul panteth for her. But what about our relationship with the Lord? Is there a longing? Is there a desire? Is there a thirst that we have that it quenches and it's a daily journey? So that's what it means to strive, because we're dissatisfied with going to the scroll. We're dissatisfied with whatever it would be that we filled ourselves with when there's something that's calling out that's saying, press on towards this. There should be this divine dissatisfaction because we're being pressed on. How are we going to press on? Well, we can be devoted. Verse 13 talks about, brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead. Brothers, let's press on. See, I do not consider I've made it my own. There's four key words in here. Could it be I have made it my own? Is it forward to what lies ahead, behind, like straining forward, forgetting what lies behind? No, it's that one thing I do. Well, there's five. My bad. See, if we had four services today, I could fix that by the second, the third, or the fourth and get my numbers down, okay? But we don't. So y'all like it, okay? So one thing I do. Too many Christians are involved in too many things for entirely too long. Too many of us are involved in too many things for entirely too long. One thing I do. What is the one thing that we're supposed to do? Forget what lies behind and press on to what is ahead. What's the one thing? The one thing is to love and lead one another to be devoted followers of Jesus. That's what matters. Loving, leading one another. Believe it or not, even now, video stream and all, no large gatherings, all that. Guess what? One another happened. It's happening. One another is happening in a unique way right now in the global church. Wow. Could God use something this horrific, this devastating? Yeah. Can it get our attention and remind us what is the one thing that we're supposed to do? Not the 50 things, not the all the different things, but what is the one thing that matters most? It's not getting our supplies and hunkering down. No, remember the verse that I shared that ministered so much to me over the last 3 months? thank God upon my every remembrance of you, in my prayer for you with joy, that the gospel that began at day one continues even now. For he who is faithful, he who began that good work, he's going to be faithful, and he's going to complete it in the day of Christ Jesus. There's one thing that mattered yesterday, that mattered 2 weeks ago, that mattered months ago and years ago, leading to this time and this moment, the one thing I do, to forget what lies behind, but press on to what lies ahead. One narrow focus, looking straight what's in front of us, right? If you're going to be an Olympic athlete, apart from, you know, if you're going to bobsled, but you also want to run the 300, the four, well, you can run 300 all you want. It's just not probably, I think there is a 300. I don't know. Anyways, beside the point, just had a conversation with myself. That's what I've been doing for the last 3 months. But anyways, but that was actually pretty funny. I'll give you guys a second out there to continue laughing. Just go ahead. Okay, that's good. No, like if you're going to bobsled, but then you also want to like ice skate, but then you also are thinking, well, what about some Summer Olympics and some X Games and all this? Like, you have to focus on one thing. I mean, you can run the 100 and the 200 and maybe the 400 or something, but you're probably not. I mean, there is a decathlon, right? People do some different things. There's some things that involve, like, skis and archery, and it's pretty amazing. But generally, you've got to focus on one thing, and that's my main problem. As a kid, I did everything. I played a lot of different sports, and I was subpar at all of them. Like, I'm talking, like, JV wannabe, you know, I'm like, if I would have focused on one, I'd be making millions of dollars just doing that one thing. But I hadn't read this verse yet, and I didn't know that there was one thing. Just focus on it, Keith. I'd have read my Bible more. I figured it out, but I didn't. Here's the problem with us. We are double-minded men and women. We're double-minded teenagers and pre-teenagers. We are double-minded children and grandparents. A double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. So we have to know the one thing. We have to know what we're about and what we should press towards. How many of you guys remember when I-84 closed about a month ago? Some of you are like, what? I guess I don't. Like, maybe like three people, okay? I know because my wife was trying to travel it. It closed for 123 miles between Baker City and Hermiston, Oregon. So she gets to Baker City with Natty in the car, and they're, you know, bopping around, you know, you're listening to, like, Lecrae, you know, and they're, like, popping, you know, and they're talking and tick-tocking. Natty doesn't talk much. He more groans and like, makes noises. But they get to Baker, and then it's like, the road is closed. They found their way through the beautiful scenery of the uttermost parts of Oregon. And so they worked their way around. You know why it closed, and then came out by Hermiston, and they were on their way to Yakima, which is just a metropolitan city out there. But it happened because the Umatilla River overflowed. Yeah. Well, there was a bunch of snow, and then it rained, and then it melted, and then all of a sudden the river covered the freeway, and they ended up closing the freeway because so much traffic backed up over a couple of days. But you drive through it now, which we did 2 weeks after that, and it looks like a swamp. You're like, okay, there is, like, stuff everywhere. Roads are being rebuilt. Well, here's the thing. If you do a bunch of things, that's what happens in your life. It overflows the banks of your life. But what happens with a river, if it stays within the banks that are designed, it is powerful. It produces power. A concentrated focus with one thing, powerful. But if you're kind of known for a lot of things, what if you were known because you devoted yourself to Jesus Christ? You're dissatisfied with what was behind, but you're pressing on to what's ahead. You say, I'm going to be devoted. There's one thing that I'm going to do. I'm going to let the river, this water my soul pants for, I'm pressing on towards. I want to stay within these boundaries of life because there is one thing that matters more than my own self-protection. It's that of Jesus Christ and his glory alone. See, there's power in having priorities. And over the last 3 months, our family has had the opportunity to narrow a focus and say, what is the most important thing? And how is the gospel alive in you? To take a second to slow down and say, okay, what should be the boundaries in our life, and what matters most? But it means we have to slow down. So what if you took this time where life is a little bit different than usual? We honor the things that our local governments and they're asking us to do in this season, but we also honor God in this season. And we say, how can I use what these boundaries that have been placed around us, the opportunity that's in front of us, for us to bring the most honor and the most glory to Him? What if now, this moment, we remember this season in our life forever because of what God did in our hearts and how we gave Him back, for some, the key to our life, and some, the one thing, we accept the one thing, the salvation that comes from God and Him alone in His Son, Jesus Christ, and it's in this season you surrendered your heart to Him. Because maybe you haven't even been in the games, because you're not that citizen of heaven that this passage talks about. You've counted on some good works here and there, and you might own a chariot. Talking about pressing on and putting your life out there on the line for other people. Like, man, I made a decision for Jesus when I was a kid. And that's pretty much it. And we have these feelings of like, yeah, because of something that happened at a time that we were never really actually changed. And that when that Caruso comes into your life and the proclaiming and heralding of the gospel of Jesus Christ, whether verbally through a person, through a song, through reading scripture, it comes and it ministers to us and we're forever changed. For we forget what lies behind and we strain forward to what lies ahead. Here's the thing. You steer where you stare. And if you be staring over here, you be steering over there as well. Where are you headed? We're supposed to forget what lies behind. What if those charioteers, I don't even know if that's a word, and don't Google me and put it in the comments below. You want to put anything in the comments below? Okay, put like a tractor or a cow or a piece of corn to honor what I'm going to talk about in a second in my childhood about driving a tractor, okay? Those charioteers, what if they looked backwards? You know, they look back, they're going to steer that way. I grew up driving a tractor. It was before GPS, okay? Global positioning systems existed where they drove themselves. No, it was the BHKPS, Bob Harrington's kid positioning systems, okay? Systems, okay? It's like, no, position your bottom in the tractor and drive for 12 hours as a 9-year-old, okay? I'm just kind of venting and letting it out, you know? My dad does watch online. Thanks for raising me, right? But in a tractor, you kind of sit off kilter a bit. You look back, you look forward, you look back. If you look back too long, you go that direction, right? If you look forward too long, you don't know what you're doing. And you're like, oh, I ran over a few things back there. Or the plow disconnected a half mile ago, but I'm rocking and going, right? It takes awareness of what has happened. See, Jesus says, no one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God. Some of us are consumed with the past. And when it says to forget, it doesn't mean like fail to remember. No, forgetting means I'm not going to be influenced or affected by it in the same manner, for I'm pressing forward to what lies ahead. And we can break the power of the past by living for the future. We can break the power that the past has by pressing on and leaning and straining and striving for what is ahead. And some of us need to hear this because your past is what's been limiting your pressing. So when you're pressed on, how do you press on? To be disciplined, right? To be devoted, to be dissatisfied with what was, but pressing on to what is. For guess what? You know what? I know where I've been, but I live for where God's taking me. I know where I've been, but I'm actually living and pressing on towards where God is taking me. Verse 14, I press on towards the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. See, this is a devotion. This is a determination. This word, I press on, it comes from the same Greek verb of I follow after, to be a devoted follower. I'm a pressed forward, pressing on, straining forward follower of Jesus Christ. The Greeks use this term, an intense endeavor, like the hunter, you know, that's going after its prey. I like that. Yeah, over, under, you know. Sorry, I'm going to stop that. It's been 3 months. I got a few things to get out of my system. But to endeavor, to chase after, to pursue the prey. We have a couple of ladies in our church that are gold medalists. Guess how they got there? It wasn't from like watching YouTube videos, okay? It wasn't like following some athletes on Instagram. Those things might have happened. It wasn't watching ESPN. No. They pressed on. They fought through. They set goals. They did so by pressing on in their specific sport, their giftings. They learned from people, but it took diligent work. It says here that there's this prize. See this runner that's pressing on? They're pressing on towards a prize of the upward call of Christ Jesus. But guess what? We live in a trophy culture, right? We live in a participation award culture. I like to call it the fairness frenzy. It's not fair. It's not fair. Well, have you read scripture? I dare you to read the Bible. I dare you to read what the Bible has to say about pressing on. For the Bible talks about different crowns that are given for those that strain, those that press, those that finish the race that's set before us. And we would say, oh, I don't know. God loves everyone. No, there's actually a standard for salvation and what it looks like to have a relationship and begin and surrendered life, what it looks like to press on through all that God has for us. And this temporary life that we live, believe it or not, there are rewards and consequences, and those are eternal things. So when eternity starts beginning to be talked about, oh, this is where it gets good, and we don't spend enough time on talking about the things of eternity. Verse 15, let those of us who are mature think this way, okay? I'm saying if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ, let's begin to think this way. If in anything you think otherwise, God will reveal that to you also. Only let us hold true to what we have attained. Brothers, and join me in imitating for keeping your eyes on. That's a very good counsel and advice for pressing on, for being disciplined, to be disciplined. Keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example that you have in us, for many of whom I've often told you, now I even tell you now with tears. Why should there be tears? Because it should be emotional when we think of things of eternity. It should be emotional, like pressing on. This should like get to the core of our heart. Like I want to press on so bad because there is one thing that I do. One thing I do. And now he's starting to call out the fact that people are not pressing on. And people have gotten caught in these, we're using so much sideways energy. Their zeal is being put towards things that don't matter for eternity. We're supposed to walk as enemies of the cross of Christ, for in the end is their destruction. For why? Their God is their belly. Notice it's a lower G. Capitalization matters. It's a lower G. You know what is their God? Not their God. Their God. It's their belly. I asked earlier, what are you thirsty for? What's going to satisfy you? Don't go grocery shopping when you're hungry. I mean, everybody's going now because they're just stocking up for when they're going to be hungry. Okay? I might have bought a few things and our kids keep eating them. I'm like, we're saving those for the end times. And the kids are like, I wanted chili. And I'm like, oh, you know, we got to have a family meeting and talk about this hoarding thing. Okay, anyways, their God is their belly. And they're hungering after things that are just going to fill them for a short bit. And guess what their glory is? It's their shame. Guess what our glory is? It's our shame when we don't press on for the one thing. Too many of us are involved in too many things entirely too long, for we made our God the desire that lives inside of this flesh. And guess what? The Lord Jesus Christ deserves more. What if your glory was his glory? What if there was one thing that you pressed for? What if your desire was just to see him face to face? Sadly, our minds are set on earthly things. But Jesus called out in what's known as like his famous sermon, the Sermon on the Mount. And what did he say? Blessed are those that hunger and thirst for righteousness, for their God is not their belly. They've been made new, and they're pressing on to what really matters, and they're pursuing that. For verse 20 tells us, for our citizenship is in heaven. We're in the race because we're a citizen. So you want to talk about if I've surrendered my life to Jesus Christ, I'm not trying to earn that because I'm a citizen of heaven. We're in the games because we've already been accepted. So this isn't a matter of working our way, performing our way, but in being a citizen, you know what you're doing. You're looking to your king, and it says, we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We're waiting, we're longing, we're running this race, we're pressing, we're straining because there is a goal, and his name is Jesus. There's a goal. There's a purpose to all this pain. There's a reason to press on when we're pressed upon because there's a goal. Verse 21, it says, who will transform our lowly bodies, which is Jesus Christ, the Lord Jesus Christ. He's going to transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself, to subdue, to subject, to bring under authority, to put the boundaries for the priority and power that comes when we stay within God's guidelines for what we long ahead, what we lunge for, what we strain for, to press on through difficult times. And we are wasting, many of us, we waste our zeal. That stuff that's inside of us that makes an athlete excellent. That God-given gifting that we all have. That social media that you have at your access where you can proclaim and testify and Caruso proclaiming and heralding the gospel of Jesus Christ. And what do? We sit back and randomly like. Just kind of wave at the neighbor. We kind of hurry and get our stuff. We take care of our children. We've made our God our belly. And our glory is shame. But if we slow down for a second, we answer the question that is posed to us in Psalm 42. See, I quoted the first part because that's a part of the song. But the song ends there. I didn't even know there was a verse 2. Verse 2 says this, for my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. And then it asks a question that wherever we're seated or standing or driving or walking your golden doodle, which is what I do 5 out of 7 days a week, because my children don't at times. But I love that baby. When I listen to podcasts and pastors and podcasters and whatever else I'm listening to, ask questions. I pray it would just make us stop for a second. And the question is this, and it's from Scripture. It's not from a heralder. No, it's from Scripture. A psalmist. When shall I come and appear before God? There's a day that we should long for, that we will appear before him. And living in the future tense will require us to focus on Christ and allow him to rearrange the things in our life according to their proper rank. So where there is a question, when am I going to appear before God? I'm in this race. There is this finish line that is there. I'm waiting for, I've trained, I'm prepared, or I'm just getting in the race. I'm just beginning a relationship with Jesus Christ. And he drops this eternal thing. Heaven awaits us. And you know why some of us want to go to heaven? Because we so dislike this miserable hell that we're living in. And I think we need to stop for a second and recognize we are thinking wrong. You're being pressed on. And you would say, I'm pressing towards heaven. No. Why do many of us want to go to heaven? Because we're going to get more of what we think we want. And more of what we think heaven is. And we think from a fleshly standpoint. And we think about us. And you know what heaven's about? It's about Jesus Christ, That's the finish line. It's his presence. It's not just getting out of this pain. No, no. Is being pressed on real? Yeah, we are being pressed on. But we should press towards. We should press towards an upward calling. We should say, I want him. Not like I want less of this. No, I want him and him alone. And that's worthy of walking across the street. And that's worthy of sending a text. And that's worthy of encouraging someone. And that's worthy of being full of joy. How about that? To be joyful, even in difficult times, to be anxious for nothing. Would you pray with me? God, we praise you. We know we are being pressed on. God, you were pressed on. No, God, you pressed on through giving your only son to the point of death, God in flesh for us. God, let us press on through all that we encounter towards that upward calling, for we are citizens of another place. We are not of this world. No, we are children of the King. Our God ain't our belly. Our God is the one worthy of our glory, the one worthy of our appetite, the one worthy of our thirst. Let our soul pant for you, for we love you. And we want to love and lead one another to be devoted followers of you. For that's all that matters, is your glory and your fame. And God, we pray that your glory would be shown throughout these times in our life, in our world, times that you foreknew and you prepared us for. We have been called out in this season. And let this be a moment, God, as a church, as the church, and as followers of you, that we press on, even though this world is trying to press us. No, we bring glory to you. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. And we have designed a special moment with a couple of songs that wherever you're at, you can sing, you can pray, and you can think about the things of eternity as these songs talk about heaven. They talk about what awaits us. They talk about who the glory is due.
Thank you. Give
We want to thank you so much for joining us today. And as we think about prayer, we want to give a couple of thoughts before we go today. How do we respond to something like this? And what we want everyone to know is we want to continue to partner with you, even though we're not meeting publicly. We still can meet online. We would love for you to email us any different requests that you have, prayer requests, or maybe even direct messages right from Facebook, from the stream where you are, and just allow us to begin to pray with and for you and whatever's going through, whatever you're going through in your life. And here's a couple thoughts towards prayer before we go today. And as we think about how do we respond to situations like this and what our world is going through, one thought would be this: Lord, make us responsible and not fearful. In 2 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 7, it says, "For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power, of love, and of self-control." Second thought would be this: that we would use this to care for others and not just ourselves. The Bible says in Philippians in chapter 2 and verses 3 and 4, it says that do nothing out of selfish ambition, but we should look not only to our own selfish interest, but also to those of the interest of others. And we take this as a time to focus on others and not just us. And the third thing would be this: Lord, would you turn our nation and our world's eyes to you and not to ourselves? Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 2, it says that looking to Jesus, the founder and the perfecter of our faith. This is a time for us to have faith over fear. Let's continue to pray together. Let's pray. Jesus, thank you so much for the time we were able to spend together worshiping you, singing to you, God, hearing your word, being challenged, being encouraged. God, you tell us that you are for us, you're not against us. God, we know that you're with us in everything that we do. Father, help us to be your hands. Help us to be your feet. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much for tuning in today. Have a great week.